Okay, now let's think about a world that operates under the gold standard. And obviously, we don't operate under the gold standard anymore, but we're going to look at the gold standard as an example of what's called bank money creation. And a lot of our banking institutions emerged when we still did have a gold standard, and some of the laws we still have are addressed to the problems that emerge with the gold standard. So we want to think about what happens when someone puts money in a bank. And suppose Mike puts 128 gold coins in the bank. So what happens is the bank, of course, gives me a receipt, and they tell me that the balance in my checking account is 128 gold coins. But then what they do is they're going to lend out some of that money. So the bank lends out, say, 64 gold coins. So it's keeping the other 64 on reserve. So it thinks I'm unlikely to come and withdraw all my money, or at least if I withdraw all my money, some other customer is unlikely to. So as long as all of it, not more than half of its customers all withdraw all their money at once, it's good. So this bank has a reserve ratio of 1/2. Okay, so when the bank lends out those 64 gold coins, these become available to be spent by someone else. So suppose it lends them out to somebody who's going to build a house, and that person builds a house, and then the person they pay to build the house deposits that money in their bank account. So 64 gold deposited in bank by, say, Norm. So we started with Mike, and my building contractor is Norm. Okay, so Norm deposits that in the bank, and he gets a receipt, or the bank tells him that it has $64 in his checking account, and then the bank keeps 32 on reserve and lends out 32. So again, it's operating with a reserve ratio of 1/2. And then this ends up being paid out to, say, M and Olivia. So Norm buys something from Olivia, and she gets 32 gold, and she deposits it and so now she has $32 in her checking account, and the bank lends out 16 and keeps 16 on reserve. Okay, and you can imagine this going on for quite some time. If you sort of follow the logic of all this, what will happen is if you look at the amount that people have in their checking accounts, just based on what we have here, I have $128 in my checking account. Norm has 64 in his checking account, and Olivia has 32 in her checking account. And you can imagine keeping on going on this. If you kept this process going kind of forever, never, never, and saw where it eventually all logically concluded to, we'd end up with 256. If we did 128 plus 64 plus 32 plus 16 plus 8 plus 4 plus 2 plus blah, 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 blah. Okay, so if we did all that, we would have 256 in people's checking accounts. And this is what we call book money or bank money. because it's money that exists on the books, and it is backed by 128 gold coins. This number right here came from what we call the money multiplier. And this piece of paper is getting kind of crowded, so I'm going to go ahead and shift to a new one. The money multiplier tells us how much bank money will eventually be created by an injection of currency. So I injected 128 gold coins into the system. Currency into the banking system. And this money multiplier, M, is equal to 1 over the reserve ratio. So in my example, with a reserve ratio of 50%, or 1/2, 1 over 50%, or 1/2, is the money multiplier, and so the money multiplier is 2. And that's how I knew that my 128 gold injection would create 2 times 128 equals 256 bank money. Okay, so that's how the bank money creation process works. And if you were sort of slightly unsettled by this, that we have $256 of bank money and only 128 gold coins to back it, you're somewhat reasonable to be unsettled by this. Essentially, there isn't enough currency to back up all the claims in the system. So if people start to withdraw their money, eventually someone's going to get caught short. In particular, the bank's going to get caught short, and some depositors are not going to be repaid in the gold that they thought that they had in their checking accounts. And this gives the incentive for what we call a bank run. That if you fear that the bank doesn't have enough gold to back up its checking accounts, then you have an incentive to run down to the bank and be the first one to withdraw your money, so that you are going to have currency and not be caught out as someone who is not going to have their money back. Bank runs are what we call a liquidity problem. So the bank would eventually have all the money needed to repay if it can have enough time for the loans to come back in. So it's a liquidity problem, and by that we mean it's a temporary mismatch between the demand for liquid assets, people wanting to withdraw their money, versus the bank having mostly illiquid assets. So if the bank is given enough time for all those loans to be repaid, it will go ahead and be able to be repaid. This is in contrast to a true bankruptcy. Bankruptcy is a situation where the bank's liabilities, its debts, are greater than its assets. So if that's true, if the bank owes more to its depositors than it's going to be repaid on its loans, even if it's having enough time for all those loans to come back, then we have a real problem. So we're going to go ahead and talk about that, which has more to do with capital ratios, in the next lecture segment.